exceptional at leading from behind are likely to be different than those who are excelled at leading from the front. And this raises the question, are we identifying and developing the leaders who can have the power of collective genius? This question and the preceding statement was posed by Linda A. Hill, Wallace Brett Dunham Professor of Business Administration at Harvard Business School and Faculty Chair of the Leadership Initiative in 2010 as part of a six-week-long blog series on how leadership might look in the future. Our guest speaker, Mr. Vijay Krishna, President of International Center, Mr. Yatin Kakodkar, members of ICG, representatives of various institutions, associations and groups, our friends from media, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning and a warm welcome to this lecture, leadership lecture, titled Leading from Behind. This is the 14th lecture as part of the ICG lecture series by Eminent Persons, which was launched in 2012. Today's lecture will be delivered by Mr. Vijay Krishna, the Executive Director of Lockheed Motors Group, part of Godrej and Boyce Manufacturing Company Limited. Please give him a big round of applause and welcome our speaker. Before we begin, I would like to invite you to like our Facebook page, the International Center Goa, to receive updates of interesting programs such as this one. You can also follow us on Twitter at ICG Goa, and you are most welcome to tweet your questions for Mr. Krishna and comments or feedback of this lecture to us at ICG Goa during the presentation. You may also subscribe to our YouTube channel, ICG Goa, and watch the videos of this lecture as well as other interesting programs that we have been organizing. Without further ado, let me invite our president, Mr. Yatin Kakodkar, to formally welcome our speaker and the guests.
Mr. Vijay Krishna, members of ICG, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and a warm welcome to all of you to yet another talk at ICG. During the last few years, we have had many experts and leaders come to ICG and deliver exceptionally brilliant lectures. The speakers have come from different backgrounds covering a wide range of subject matter. From the world of law and judiciary, we have had Justice Santosh Hegde talk about the role of Lok Ayukta in good governance. We have had the legendary Justice J.S. Verma, former Chief Justice of India, talk about the role of judiciary in good governance. Recently, we have had Attorney General of India, Mukul Rohatgi, speak on India's judicial system. From the world of social policy and social justice, we have had Aruna Roy and Nikhil Dey talk about the challenge of fighting corruption and redressing grievances. And Harsh Mandar talked about reclaiming the idea of government for the poor. From the world of foreign affairs, we have had several ambassadors come and deliver lectures pertaining to India's foreign policy. Lord Meghnad Desai spoke about good governance and economic success. Former election commissioner Dr. S. Y. Qureshi and J. M. Lindo spoke on electoral reforms. From the world of science, nuclear scientist Dr. Anil Kakodkar spoke on just for promoting a green economy. Defense expert Commodore Uday Bhaskar spoke about India's maritime security, challenges and opportunities. Recently, historian Ramchandra Guha spoke sieges about the politics in India since the BJP was elected to power in 2014. The list is legion. And today we have Mr. Krishna talking about leading from behind under the ICG lecture series by eminent persons. Mr. Krishna is not just an eminent person, but is uniquely multifaceted, with experience in management, business, theatre, advertising, mountaineering, biodiversity and reforestation. Today's talk will be different from the ones we typically have at ICG, such as public policy, social policy, politics, international affairs, gender issues, media and so on. Today Mr. Krishna will talk on leadership. I have not seen or heard the presentation, but read a brief synopsis of the talk. The synopsis is interesting. It contains information and suspense. But suspense in the synopsis is to be expected from Mr. Krishna, for whom theatre and dramatics is one of his first loves. Nevertheless, the talk will take us to the world of exploration of the natural world and the epic expedition of the taken by Sir. Nevertheless, the talk will take us to the world of exploration of the natural world and the epic expedition of the Antarctica, taken by Sir Ernest Shackleton about 100 years ago. And the talk will expound on the themes of bravery, courage, and leadership that resonate from the expedition. I have no doubt we'll all enjoy the talk and go home enriched. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a warm welcome to all of you on this Saturday morning at ICG. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. At the end of this lecture, we would like all of you to kindly fill up the feedback forms that have been given to you and hand it over to us at the registration desk. Before we invite the celebrity speaker, the star speaker, Mr. Krishna, to deliver his lecture, may I request Mr. Sanjeev Trivedi to kindly introduce Mr. Krishna to us.
Good morning, friends. After what Yatira said, my introduction seems redundant. But somewhere like the iceberg in Antarctica, Yatira has shown you the tip of the iceberg. It's a privilege for me to introduce dear friend Vijay Krishna. As the poster says, he's the executive director of Rock Camera Company, turned around. But there's much more than that to him. In 5 decades, in the theatre industry, he's one of the most formidable pillars of the Indian theatre industry. Not many people know that he's played a cameo role with Roger Moore, David Niven, and Gregory Peck in Goa, I think in the 1070s when they were all young. I've had the pleasure of spending many days, 24 hours a day, with Vijay when he goes sailing. And eclectic and erudite are the two adjectives that perfectly fit him, because we never seem to run out of topics for conversation. Even if it's 8 days, 24 hours a day, we have something to talk about, and it's really fascinating. He's a keen mountaineer, having hiked the volcanoes in the Himalayas. He's done the English Way walk to Santiago de Compostela, if I'm pronouncing it correct. He's also involved in a lot of environmental protection areas like water conservation. He's founded the Naurudu Center for Plant Research for propagating and educating people about medicinal plants. So there are many, many facets, and I think today we have time for one facet, and that is his exploration of the Shackleton's expedition 1 century later and the lessons we can learn from it. So, enjoy the feast.
Googled it, and I read other accounts by men who'd been on the same expedition. And interestingly, all their stories reaffirmed the details that the gentleman had mentioned. So I told the story to the workmen in my factory. And even though I told it to them in my poor Hindi, their mother tongue being Marathi, and of course the fact that they are never going to see snow in their lives, they seem to appreciate how extraordinary the story was. So today I'm going to tell you the story. And I hope that you enjoy it as much as they did. It's a a story of a man who failed every objective that he set himself in life. And yet, when he was tested, really and supremely tested, beyond belief, beyond all known levels of challenge, endurance, and adversity, he came up trumps. And it wasn't just personal triumph. He inspired the people around him to work together as a team, working together better than each could ever have achieved by himself to stay alive. It still ranks as the greatest adventure story ever told and the greatest survival story of them all. And maybe there's something for all of us to learn from such a story. So thank you for inviting me here to chant with you. I want to thank, before I start, I'd like to thank my company, Godrej, which affords me the opportunity to come down here and talk to you like this. I'd also like to thank my assistant, Dagmar, who's sitting over there, who helps me put together the presentations and hopefully make them come alive for you. But I have to warn you that you also have a job to do in order to bring my story to a full circle. You have got to identify your personal resonances, if any, from the story, to think over these, ponder the elements in them that make sense to you. Try and put yourself into the place of different players in the story as the story changes course. And it does change course. It twists and turns like the devil. What would you have done in those people's shoes? It's an extraordinary story, and you may find yourself a little overwhelmed by the course of it. So just relax. Enjoy your visit with me to a place you've probably never been to and which I'm pretty sure you never will. It's a place that we can't compare our normal experiences to because the ambient conditions there are the most extreme in the world. And here is a glimpse of what I saw when I visited there in 2012. This is the tip of South America, Ushuaia. We're just setting out across the Great Passage. Stormiest passage in the world, bar none. Because the Southern Ocean is the stormiest sea in the world. And then 2.5 days later, we got across, and that was our first sighting of the mainland. And that's when you get your first taste of a land of ice. Kilometers in every direction. apple seed who came up to bite our rubber boat. You can't see it very clearly, but this is a mighty humpback whale sounding, diving down. This guy was 20 feet away from us. So we were literally the intruders in there. The things are happening there, climate change is happening for a start. And of course, no Antarctic visit is complete without what they call a polar plunge. And I went there with a famous British explorer. He's the guy on the right over there. And this is my own school flag. And he was the first man to walk unaided to both poles. Now, my own credentials as your guide on this story are very few. Merely that from the age of 7, walking 3 miles to school and back every day across the hill station of Simla, of course, the summer capital of the old British Raj, made me enjoy walking and being very aware later of the great outdoors, helping me to enjoy travel to unusual places in our world. And today I worry about the precarious state of water availability on our planet, which brings me straight away to our destination, the most special place in the world, Antarctica. 70% of Earth's fresh water in its ice, and the setting for our story. And of course, I hope we're going to find inspiration from there to make us better people sitting over here. Now, the thing about Antarctica compared to other extreme places, that even today, it's just that much more extreme. And all these boats have had trouble just in the last few years, just going across the same place, the same journey that I took in 2012. And its remoteness makes it so sensitive to the extreme weather conditions around Antarctica. And this factor, I should tell you, was an unknown in the early days, the expedition that I'm going to tell you about, because technology was much less advanced then, information was scarce. So planning to cope with these extreme conditions was very faulty, and therefore, many people died on every single expedition. But the importance of this place to our world is so special that we just need to take note of it. The sheer size of our seventh continent.
So here I'm sitting in this lovely warm lab, and just outside is the environment that Scott and Shackleton first faced when they came here about 100 years ago. Unlike Scott and Shackleton, who viewed the ice as this sort of static monster that had to be crossed to get to the South Pole, we scientists now are able to see the ice as a dynamic living entity that is sort of producing change, like the icebergs that I study. For me, it's been a wild ride. First of all, I found out that the iceberg that I came down to study not only was larger than the iceberg that sank the Titanic, it's not only larger than the Titanic itself, but it was larger than the country that built the Titanic. That's pretty big. This is B-15. So what we see here is the White Cliff. It's about 150 feet tall. So that means that there's over 1,000 feet of ice below the waterline. This iceberg is so big that the water that it contains would run the flow of the River Jordan for 1,000 years. It's so big that the water that is inside of it would run the River Nile for 75 years.
So all that fresh water and its ice, which is why, of course, people say, scientists say, that in case those ice sheets ever melt,
sea level goes up.
So cities that are going to be close to coastlines which will be under severe threat. So nothing in our comfortable world prepares us for Antarctica. In its waters are predator leopard seals, killer whales, while inland conditions are just too extreme for anything to survive. In fact, strangely enough, the largest creature on Antarctica is this little insect, which is 1.5 inches long, which freezes in winter and unfreezes the next summer. Incredibly strong winds blow all the time. These are called katabatic winds, which come off the Antarctic ice cap at recorded speeds of over 200 miles per hour, which is higher than any typhoon ever recorded. So he's going out to show us just how windy it is out there. 107 knots, that's about 120 miles per hour. Pictures of old explorers in the old days show them normally crawling around on all fours just to combat these kind of winds. Now he's coming, he's just next to the hut. You can imagine being out on the Antarctic ice cap and being subjected to winds like that. It's a different kettle of fish. And of course, it is the coldest place in the world. But funny enough, people don't know that it's also the driest place, because the cold, dry winds coming off the Antarctic ice sheets make some valleys so dry that it hasn't rained over there for the last million years. And in fact, today's cutting-edge research in Antarctica points to the possible life forms that we may find on Mars when the Mars expeditions get there. Dangerous glaciers everywhere deform the surface, and all these lines that you see over here are actually crevices like you see over there, and these can be 150 feet deep and up to 50 feet wide. In fact, that large snow cap was from the 1959 expedition that finally crossed Antarctica for the first time, and it almost fell inside that crevice. But luckily they managed to get up. So, welcome to Antarctica. For centuries, the least understood place on Earth. Now, our journey begins on August 5th, 1914. And as World War I guns begin to boom, the British Admiralty, helmed by, of course, a young Winston Churchill, cleared this polar expedition to sail from England to Antarctica. And its objective was to cross from the north and then go right across the entire continent on foot, which was a pretty outsized ambition considering the entire continent was unknown at that time. In fact, in the 19th century, its name was Terra Australis Incognita, which meant the unknown southern land. And this Russian expedition in 1820, were actually the first human beings to actually see Antarctica. And the wonderful thing about this is that the ancient Greeks, millions of years before, actually felt that some landmass that they called Antarctos must exist in the south to balance the lands in the north that they knew about. And they called those lands Arctos, the bear. Obviously, because it lay under the star sign of the bear. And amazingly, they were right. The ancient Greeks were right. Because 225 million years ago, all lands on Earth were part of one giant continent called Pangaea. And that then giant tectonic convulsions started breaking it first in two, and then again and again. And the fragments that we know today are our continents. India broke free from Antarctica and Australia about 130 million years ago and then moved north. Odisha's coastline actually once joined Antarctica's eastern side. And then in the 1890s, Scottish geographer John Bartholomew finally named it Antarctica on the world maps. Now, man first began sailing maybe 50,000 years ago in East Asia. Sea levels were lower then. He was exploring. Then he traveled later to colonize, and finally, of course, to conquer. And at first, since the seas were shallower, the ocean's color indicated where he was. Then, when journeys became longer, he started looking to the stars. And the object, of course, was to reach the destination, not the speed at which you reached it. Then scientific advances brought compasses, clocks, and sextants. And around that time, man discovered forces within Earth which created the difference between magnetic north and true north. And of course, mankind had discovered Earth's magnetic field. And understanding how that worked, of course, took centuries longer. And it involved Europe's finest scientific minds in what was actually called then the Magnetic Crusades. Imperial empires would send their ships out of the oceans to map how data changed between the equator and the poles. England's Royal Navy, through their great Captain James Cook, made three epic voyages, mapping data and discovering in the process Australia's Barrier Reef, New Zealand, and the presence of Antarctica in the 1770s, although he didn't actually see it himself. And then in 1831, Captain James Clark Ross of the Royal Navy charted the North Magnetic Pole, and later in 1840 off the Ross Sea, almost reached the South Magnetic Pole. And then some disastrous Arctic expeditions took all attention away from the Magnetic Crusades. So, as the 20th century dawned, Antarctica remained a blank on world maps. Finally, in 1901, England's Royal Geographical Society, fearing several countries might get to the poles before them, persuaded the Royal Navy to send its first expedition south since the days of Captain James Clark Ross. And Clement Markham, who's the guy over there from the Royal Geographical Society, he, as far as he was concerned, Britain needed to be first at the pole. But Captain Scott, the jaunty chap in the straw hat over there, was its leader, and he knew little of Antarctic waters or Antarctic conditions. He came from the Royal Navy, and Royal Navy traditions frowned on strange things like fraternizing between sailors and officers, which turned out to be a restricting factor when you needed to adapt quickly to changing polar conditions. But one man on board wasn't Royal Navy. He was Merchant Marine officer Ernest Shackleton. And the father of a fellow officer on one of his ships, a gentleman called Llewellyn Longstaff, had actually underwritten the Antarctic expedition. And Longstaff happened to be traveling with them, so Shackleton persuaded his friend to introduce him to his father, and he so impressed Longstaff that he recommended him to the expedition. Now, social scientists will tell you that your parental and your family interactions and all these relationships literally define how you are going to behave and act in life. And Ernest Shackleton, who was the second of eight adoring sisters and a younger brother over there, he's up there on the top, and he just grew up as a natural elder brother, protective, caring, strong, and yet, as people said later of him, with almost a feminine sensibility. He was a great listener, naturally, with all those brothers and sisters, he needed to be a great listener. He was no great student. His first biographer, in fact, and a great friend of his, said his study grades were decidedly south of the equator and perilously close to the pole. And he just persuaded his father to send him to sea. But his country doctor father couldn't afford a Royal Navy cadet ship and felt that he might perhaps dampen these maritime notions by apprenticing him in to the Merchant Marine. at the sweet age of 16 years old. Funny enough, his school grades shot up as soon as he knew that he was going into the merchant marine. And then he landed the job and he stuck it out despite the tremendously tough apprenticeship, which included loading and unloading of cargoes places all around the world, including in India, where some of his ships landed. It wasn't the stuff of his school daydreams, but he was obstinate. And finally, he qualified for master marinership by the age of 24. So that meant, of course, that he was qualified to lead a vessel anywhere in the world. But now, he wanted to get married. He was dreaming of polar adventure already. And both of these were answered by impressing Longstaff to get to the South Pole. Now, the Brits in those days brought their rather preconceived notions to polar exploration. They thought of dogs as pets, not as sledge pullers. Skis were jokey things used by foreigners like Norwegians. And obviously, the only manly way to get to the pole was to pull your sledges there. In fact, these Viking thoughts actually would turn out to be fatal for a lot of people. In fact, it was just lucky that Scott's three-man pole, and you can see Shackleton over there, Scott in the middle, and Dr. Edmund Wilson over there on the other side, they got to within 400 miles of the pole. And it was fortunate because scurvy hit them. Now, those of you who are fortunate enough not to have contracted scurvy would remember that it actually killed more people in the great age of sail than wars, storms, and disease combined. An estimated 2 million died of scurvy in the old days. And of course, it was lack of vitamin C on very long voyages without fresh fruit or vegetables. In fact, the Royal Navy squadron in the 1740s, which raided Spanish shipping routes, lost 1,300 men out of 2,000 to scurvy. And lack of vitamin C, remember, affects what's known as collagen creation. And it is collagen that binds body tissues together. So, once you get scurvy, literally the body starts falling apart. Not very nice. And Shackleton, who was the worst affected, was sledged by Scott back to base. And then within a few days, he was sent home, hinting strongly that he was unfit for polar travel. Shackleton, of course, never forgave him. It became one of the great rivalries of early exploration. And he went and assembled, a little later, his own 1907 expedition, which got to within 100 miles of the pole. And he only returned when it became very evident that their food supplies were not going to get them to the pole and then get back to base. And that decision won Shackleton fame and a knighthood. In fact, explorers became the rock stars of that age. Of course, Scott couldn't leave it at that. So he returned again in 1910, again refusing dog teams and skis. But when Scott reached Australia, he got a telegram from a competitor. And everybody thought that Norwegian Roald Amundsen had gone to the North Pole. And yet here he was, gaily telegramming him that he was on his way to the South Pole. Now, this was the height of bad manners. I mean, you didn't actually start racing people to the pole then. You know, when somebody set out, first he finished, then he came back. And if he didn't make it, then it was clear for everybody else. And here was Roald Amundsen about to start racing Scott to the pole. And Amundsen was the complete pro. He'd already spent one Antarctic winter ice still. He was the first to sail the legendary Northwest Passage, which of course was the trade route that connected the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans across the Arctic. He was Eskimo clothing, and now he had his great countryman Fridtjof Nansen's boat Fram, which was designed to last out winters ice still, because the bow of the ship was rounded. So when it got iced in, it would force the boat up to the surface, which was an unusual design that Nansen had come up with. Anyway, to cut a long story short, he reached the pole 34 days before Scott, because he was aiming just to get to the pole and back. He was not doing any fancy notions like scientific sort of endeavors and all that kind of stuff along the way, which Scott had sort of targeted it doing. And Scott, stupidly, had added an extra man at the last minute, which left less food and nourishment for all that sledge pulling. You know, they were pulling their own sledges. And then they were very unlucky to have a spell of freezing weather hit them. And they started dying one by one. The strongest went first, Teddy Evans. He died first. He was exhausted, his mind was wandering. Second to go was Captain Oates, who was an Indian Army man, and he had scurvy, nastily reopened an old war wound of his. So he knew that he was slowing the deed. So he just hobbled out into a snowstorm, saying, "I'm going outside and I may be some time, just to not to hold up the others." Wilson, Bertie Bowers of the Royal Indian Marine, and Scott died trapped by another snowstorm. So the nation mourned. Now, Shackleton, who was sailing on August 5th, 1914, wanted to go one better. Now, it was too late to go to the pole because Amundsen had already got there. So he was going to walk right across an unknown Antarctica for the first time. Who was this guy, Shackleton? We've heard that he was an experienced merchant seaman, and he definitely wasn't a Royal Navy man. On his ship, everyone had to do everything, including swabbing the decks. And this particular picture beautifully illustrates that, because the guy on the left is James Worthy, who was one of the scientists on board. The guy in the middle is an officer of the ship, Cheatham, and the chap on the left, on the right over there, is a guy called Dr. McElroy, who had been brought on to actually deal with not just the humans on board, but also the dogs. So, beautifully illustrating what kind of a team Shackleton was putting together. And of course, the guys he had were terrific chaps. They included, he chose them all himself. They included grizzled Antarctic veterans like the first officer, a guy called Frank Wild, who was a little tough little guy, ended up with four polar expeditions, and those are the medals from his expeditions. There was first officer Frank, Tom Crean, the second officer, and he was from Ireland, very strong guy. He won the Albert Medal, again for an incredible rescue of an expedition with Scott. And both these guys, by the way, had served with Scott. Remember, there was tremendous rivalry in those days. Both of them had served with Scott and now were coming with Shackleton. Then there was small boat expert, who was a Kiwi, Frank Worsley, and he turned out to be, the words brilliant don't illustrate it enough, as you'd see. He was just an incredible navigator. Useless at leading, but a terrific navigator. And then, of course, there was this unusual guy who was an Australian photographer called Frank Hurley. And Shackleton had seen one of his films, and again on a Scott expedition, and knew that this guy was the one, so he sent him an invitation. When Hurley got the invitation, he was out in the Australian bush somewhere on another expedition, and he just dropped everything, made his way to Sydney, and took the next boat and landed up in Buenos Aires, which illustrates not just the high price that, because everybody wanted to go to the Antarctic. And so it shows not only did he prize the experience of going with Shackleton, but also just going to the South. His Cambridge scientists were in their early 20s, and some of them, like James Worthy over here, would go on to be terrific polar leaders themselves. In fact, Worthy would captain his own polar expeditions right into the 50s. And remember, this is 1914,
in fact. We haven't got to 1916 yet. So those were the kind of guys who were on board there. There were other chaps also. And this is a very nice photograph of Eddie. And it shows one of the sailors on board. And it's a chap called Vincent. And Vincent had amassed a reputation among the ship's crew. He was a very strong man. And he was started bullying the other people. So this got him into information. So Shackleton decided to tackle him. Now the way he had to tackle him was also illustrative of the way he dealt with people. He pulled him into his cabin one day. Nobody knew what took place because it was just between him and Vincent. But when he came out, when Vincent came out, he was a changed man. And that's how Shackleton dealt with people. Never pulled up anybody in front of anybody else. This was his famous ad for the expedition. You can't read it from where you're sitting, but it says strange things. Hazardous journey, small wages, long months of constant darkness, constant danger, safe return, doubtful, honor and recognition in case of success. Now what's he saying there? He's laying it on the line just as it was. He's not making any promises. He's telling you that's how it's going to be. Yeah, you may come out and you may get some fame and recognition afterwards, but first you've got to get through this. And who knows whether you will get through it or not. Interesting. So, he wanted people, basically, who were jolly, they had to be good natured, they had to be positive. Above all, they had to be positive, because Shackleton, above all people, knew just what it was like to be out there for a year, 2 years maybe, who knows how long an expedition would take. And that the people would have to last out that long. His meteorologist, for example, was a guy called Leonard Hussey. And he just returned from an expedition to the Sudan. So Shackleton thought that was very funny. And he told Hussey later, Hussey asked him, in fact, why did you hire me? And he said, because I thought you looked funny. But he actually chose him for something else. He chose him for a particular skill that Shackleton considered vital mental medicine. Just to test whether you all are awake or not, what do you think that might have been? What skill could that have been? Can't hear you.
Humor.
Psychiatric, did you say? Okay. A skill. Talking about a skill.
Music.
Sorry?
Music.
As it happens, you're quite right. It was music. He played the banjo. And above all things, Shackleton knew that at least somebody needed to know an instrument. Because when they're out there, days, weeks, months, maybe years, you would need to keep people's spirits up. And the best thing that does that is music. You'll be astonished that here in India, how many audiences never got to that part of it, that it would be music. And it's strange because we are musical people. When he arrived finally at Buenos Aires on 26th October, Shackleton found the cook drunk on the table and the sailors all out carousing, doing the things that sailors do in ports. Now, Antarctic conditions are harsh. And discipline is absolutely critical. So he immediately replaced several of them and restored order and made it clear as to who was the boss of this expedition. Now Worsley had been the captain out from England, but he was just couldn't control the men. So Shackleton took hold. And about 2 days out, funnily enough, Frank Wild, the first officer, discovered a pair of feet sticking out from one of the clothes bins. He had a stowaway on board. It was this young guy, 18 years old, step on first black pearl from Wales. And when he was pulled out from the clothes bin, Shackleton ordered him down in front of the whole ship's crew. And there he lashed into him so strongly that one of the sailors actually thought that he was going to throw him overboard. And then, finally, he sternly told Black Pearl that if ever they were going to be in an emergency, he would be the first to be eaten. So then, Black Pearl knew that he was off the hook, and that it was okay. And then he eventually turned around and retorted to Shackleton, "But sir, you've got more meat on you." Anyway, they reached South Georgia from Buenos Aires. And this was a typical whaling station in South Georgia. Now remember, whaling became so prominent because that was the oil in those days. You hadn't started drilling down below the earth as you do today. And so whale blubber had to be chopped out from the whale after killing it, of course. And in fact, in the process, they practically eliminated whales, etc. It was terrible. And what the whalers told him over there was that the winter ice had set in early. Now, he's reached in December. Now, remember that December is summer, actually, in the southern hemisphere. So, if the ice had already set in, this was months before it should be. So this was not a good news to him. So he hung around there for a while, and here you see one of the fantastic photographs that Hurley took over there. And I'd like you to remember this picture, because what it shows is South Georgia as it was in those days. It was a windy, stormy, icy, unmapped island. In fact, it wasn't mapped right until the 1950s. So this was an unknown island for all practical respects. It was just the whaling station that you can see it way over there down in the fjord. Shows the kind of conditions that they were going into. So he couldn't wait any longer. He decided that he had to get going. So on December 5th, 1914, he set sail. And you can guess who that is. That's, of course, Early over there, Frank Early. He was the kind of guy who had to get the best photograph possible. So he's over there, right out there on the rigging. You can imagine what guts it would have taken to walk across that mast in icy weather. And this was icy weather. They were going to the most dangerous place on earth. The weather was going to be bad. They knew that already. And they didn't have a radio transmitter. They had no money. The budget didn't last for transmitters. So all they had was a receiver. So you could receive information. You couldn't tell anybody where you were in case you had a problem. So, from now on, they were totally out of touch.
One day in late 1914, one
of the attempts
as important Antarctic expedition started to go badly wrong. On this day began a two-year nightmare of hardship, catastrophe, and ultimately, heroism of the highest order.
So within days, he hit the ice. And the loose ice quickly turned more solid, and soon the ship was getting caught by the ice.
The 300-ton Endurance manually into open water. For close to 2 days, the crew works with virtually no rest, exhausting themselves battling against the ice. When they are at the point of dropping, Shackleton has his crew push the ship backwards as far as she will go. He intends to ram his way through ice that was up to 18 feet thick. While he stands alone on the deck, the ship valiantly plows to within 400 yards of open water, but can go no farther. On February 24th, 1915, Shackleton gives up trying to free the ship, and the Endurance becomes a winter station. She will drift with the vagaries of the pack ice, which will take her anywhere it wants.
Now just think to yourself what you've just seen in this video. They got stuck in the ice, which everybody knew was not just a bad deal, but meant that you were stuck for the entire several months later when you would be caught by the currents, etc. But what is Shackleton doing? He knows damn well that he can't get that ship unstuck. But he's still keeping the men positive, he's making them do things, he's putting them to jobs, keeping their minds occupied, because nothing hits them in activity. And so even though he knew that there was no way on earth that they were going to cut that ship out, he still put the men through the motions. That's the kind of guy he was. Anyway, as you heard, on February 24th, he declared the ship a winter station. Now, under Royal Navy rules, once the ship became a winter station, it was no longer a ship. And because it was no longer a ship, wages wouldn't be paid. Those were Royal Navy rules. So he was stuck as, you know, the storekeeper put it, like an almond in the middle of a chocolate bar, just 60 miles off the Antarctic coast. So he was stuck before starting. Now reality started slowly dawning on everybody, like a bad dream. I mean, this was a huge, huge disappointment. What did Shackleton do? Never for one instant did he show it. He merely shifted his objective, as he told his men, from going to the pole to ensuring safe return for his men. Never once did he mention to anybody his crushing finances, the money that had to be repaid to sponsors, and all that kind of thing. He immediately just set up, as he'd always done before, daily tasks, work schedules, and training the 69 dogs on board. And this was, of course, to keep men and minds occupied. And in fact, strong bonds got established between men and the dogs. Here is Tough Tom Crean with all the puppies that were born on board. And here, Hussey, the smallest of the men, is playing with Samson, who is the largest of the dogs. They played games on the ice, and they had, you know, they did things like this for all the working hours of the day. They also, importantly, had to prepare for the frequent whiteout storms that are a common sort of occurrence over there. So what they're doing is they're setting out lines from in every direction from the ship. And this is so because in a whiteout storm, you can hold your hand in front of your face and you can't see your hand. That's what a whiteout storm actually does to you, or it doesn't do to you, whichever way you're looking at it. Now here is a photo taken in September. They've been 6 months on the ice, and what it shows to me is the value of keeping minds occupied. They're actually looking fairly cheerful. Now, by this time, in other expeditions, people had actually started killing each other. They started running amok, losing balance, etc. Anyway, so
July 14th, 1915. all hands standing by. We had a slight shock last night. There was a noise under the bottom aft, the same as if the ice had broken up. The boss thinks it was a whale, but I think it's different.
Shackleton orders a special watch. It is a stressful and exhausting night, and in the morning, the pressure looks even worse. The assaults by the ice continue for weeks.
The wind howled in the rigging, and I couldn't help thinking it was making just the sort of sound you would expect a human being to utter if they were in fear of being murdered. Shackleton said at length, "You'd better make up your mind that it is only a matter of time."
October 18th, 1915. The Endurance has been trapped for 9 months. A wave of pressure causes the ship to keel over 30 degrees in a matter of seconds. Bent and twisted, she begins to leak dangerously. All hands work ceaselessly throughout an interminable night, pumping and repairing the damage. Even blankets are used to try to contain the leak. At 5 p.m. on October 27th, Shackleton gives the order to abandon ship.
The attack of the ice reached a climax.
So what's happening here? What's happening is that as summer goes into winter, the ice is beginning to work. And what is happening is, remember, they're only about 6 to 8 feet above the water. Oh yeah, they're on literally on a slab of ice. And that ice is now beginning to work in different directions because the current is moving it in different directions. And it's beginning to break up the ship. So what he's doing is that it's too unsafe to remain on the ship. So he moves people off the ship. And now the game had changed dramatically. Because it's one thing to be nice and safe and warm on board the ship. Now you're on the ice. And the ice is a very different kettle of fish, as anybody who's been in a situation like that, which I hope none of you have been, happens. Because in little ways, things change. For example, you've been working all day because your boss has been putting you through all the work, etc. And you go to sleep at night. And the sweat that you've accumulated during the day is frozen on you. You get into your sleeping bag and it starts turning into water. So by the time you wake up in the morning, the bottom of your sleeping bag is now full of water. Those are the kind of conditions that they were now into and facing for the first time. So it was huge, huge dramatic change. And that was why, actually, in little ways, they now started seeing that this guy somehow is going to save them. How the hell he's going to do that, who knows. And one of the ways in which this became apparent was what one of the sailors who'd been taken on at Buenos Aires wrote about later. And he talked about an unfair deal that had happened. What was the unfair deal? That lots had been drawn for the use of a lot of fine reindeer skin sleeping bags and ordinary woolen sleeping bags. So they couldn't barter them all, so they drew lots. And lo and behold, at the end of the drawing of the lots, the seamen got the fine bags and the officers got the ordinary ones. So what he was doing was he was demonstrating to them beyond normal sort of reasoning that he had a sense of rightness, he had a sense of balance, and that's the way it would be going forward. So they knew who they were dealing with, what kind of person they were dealing with. And look at how he's talking of Shackleton, thinking of his men first and himself last. This is an ordinary seaman, by the way. Now remember one other thing, which I didn't tell you about, is that you've got different sets of animals on board this ship. And I don't mean the dogs. You've got seamen who see life in a particular way. You've got officers who see life in a very different way. And then you've got the scientists who see life in yet another way. And all these three groups of men had to be dealt with by the guy in charge. And if you do it badly or you don't do it adequately, things happen. Things get out of control. And so that's really what is coming through to me out here, is the men, ordinary seamen, talking like that. Then on November 21st, finally it happened.
Within a few days, the Endurance loses her final struggle.
This is the actual footage from the Endurance. Watching from a distance from the camp, and shackled the gun to his guys and said, "She's going, boys." And they saw the ship going down. Stern was the last to go under. And as he writes over there in his diary, "I cannot think about it. Now what's happened here? It's a key change. Yet again. Once again, the picture has changed totally. Now their one chance to sail away from here is gone. The ship's gone. A sailor's ship is his home. It's not just a ship. And now it was gone. So that's why he's confessing to his diary that he had no words to describe what was in his mind. So how did he react? How would you react? What he did was he gathered the men around him. Quietly he told them that now the ship was gone, it was time to go home. Not for a minute did he betray helplessness or shock. He just remained calm, even though the men could very well think for themselves and say, "How the devil is he going to do that?" But it was so infectious what he was doing, the way he was reacting, that he just gave the men, his calmness gave the men positive hope as usual. Now, they would go on to move camp three more times in the months that followed. He even tried twice to drag the three lifeboats. They had three lifeboats on board, and those were still with them. Now, he wanted to drag them to the mainland, but the snow was just too soft, the ground was too uneven. As you can see over here, it's not one level sort of playing field over there. And the boats were just too heavy. It was more than rough going. It was impossible. The second time, Shackleton had gone ahead of the men to scout out the land in front. And he thought he didn't hear any noises coming. So he turned back and he saw that all work had stopped. So he quickly came back. Worsley was in charge of the detail. And what had happened was that McNeish, who was the ship's carpenter, he was the oldest man on board. He was 47 years old. And he was at this point in time plagued by piles. So finally it was too much for him. He stepped out to the traces and he refused to pull. And he pulled ship's law on them because he said that since the ship had gone, ship's orders no longer applied to him. So he wasn't going to pull anymore. So it was a key moment, very, very pivotal moment, because now everybody's depressed, everybody's feeling bad. One guy has finally said, "I'm not going to do it." How did he react? Quietly, he took McNeish into his tent and told him what was really a little white lie. He told him that his contract bound him to Shackleton personally, not to the ship. So therefore, he still owed responsibility to Shackleton, and he was going to make sure that his wages would be paid until he returned, which was an interesting fact that he was doing. He was sticking out his neck over here. And basically, once again, he was just showing the men how much he felt for them. What happened? McNeish went back into the traces. They went on pulling for several days, in fact. The ice drift in the meantime was taking them even further from the mainland. And then finally, Shackleton stopped what was clearly a hopeless task. Once again, what he had done was, it underscored the lengths that he was going to try to get people safely home. But he never forgave McNeish for what he considered was disloyalty at a critical moment. Now, food was running out. So Shackleton ordered hunting of seals and penguins. He refused to stockpile meat. That was a suggestion that it made to them, because he felt that if he did that, that would signal possible disaster ahead, and then that would put mental strain on the men, and therefore thoughts of insanity, etc., that might bring. In his book, starving was preferable to insanity. So instead, what did he do? He ordered the dogs shot in relays. A seal fed them for a day, while a dog would feed them for a week. Sledging to the mainland was clearly impossible, so that made the dogs redundant. That's the kind of maths that takes place when your life hangs in the balance. Again, it underscored for the men their dangerous situation and how for Shackleton, definitely, they were number one. Frank Wilde was the guy who got the nasty job of putting the dogs down. And as he said in his diary, it was the worst job I ever had. I've known men I'd rather shoot than the worst of dogs. Finally, on April 9th, their ice floe started breaking up. And now Shackleton ordered the boats into the water. Once again, it's a total change. Now they're into the water. Not just into the water. The ice floes around them are breaking. The wind is coming from all directions. The current is also going in all directions. So it's very, very dangerous. Nothing had prepared them for this. Few of them had small boat experience, yet now they have to row the boats under the most dangerous conditions in the world. Well, here you see what the artist who was also on board painted of the expedition. This was the first night. They pulled up to a nice floe and they made camp on the ice floe. And as Shackleton was pacing around at night, wondering what to do next, how he was going to keep handling things, a loud crack rang out. And Shackleton knew immediately that the ice floe had started cracking. So he quickly went into the nearest tent, and what did he see in the tent? A man in his sleeping bag already inside the water. So, without thinking, he reached in and with one arm heaved the man and his bag out of the water, and then the ice floe cracked shut behind them. These were abnormal conditions. Frightful, driving sleet, strong winds. They didn't get a chance again to pull up on the ice after that. And now the men were starting to get seriously affected. So Shackleton was looking around carefully all the time at the men. When he saw that somebody was getting particularly badly affected, he would quickly order hot milk for everybody so that the individual wouldn't feel too bad about it and everybody was benefited. Food was so meager that one man said, we had one biscuit, which we looked at for breakfast, sucked for lunch, and ate for dinner. Some sucked their shoes just to get some sort of liquid into their mouths. Some of the men had a rather unpleasant affliction, which I won't describe for you, but basically the dog meat had gone wrong. So now some of the men had to evacuate their bowels constantly. Now, it's all one thing when you need to evacuate your bowels in a safe environment. Here they're on a boat, a bucking boat, which is rocking around in the way, and these guys had to then evacuate their bowels. So you could just imagine to yourself this frightful, frightful part of the journey, which was now the worst part of the journey that they had to undertake up to now. So,
for the next 7 days, they fight a heroic battle. The storms are enormous. They go days without sleep. Thirst becomes overwhelming, and their mouths and tongues are so swollen, they cannot swallow food.
They were really in bad shape.
Leading them through 17 hours of darkness each day is Frank Worsley, Shackleton's brilliant navigator.
The temperature was
now he came into his own.
Greenstreet's right foot had got badly frostbitten, but Lee's restored it by holding it in his sweater against his stomach. My eyes began to fail me. I could not see or judge distance properly and found myself falling asleep at the tiller.
We've been awake for 80 hours.
Yet Worsley's uncanny navigation brings the three battered craft to the bleak shores of Elephant Island. The men have not touched solid ground in more than 16 months. For the first time in 3 days, they have a meal and a hot drink.
497 days, they hadn't been on solid land. So they'd been on ice for this time. And now they were there. And what happened was that as they got onto this island in the middle of nowhere, some of the men went crazy. So a group of an ants walked around down the coast a little bit to where they found a colony of penguins and seals, and just savagely started hacking them to death. Shackleton looked at them, understood what was going on, quietly brought them back, persuaded them to come back, and put them to sleep. It was sleep was it. But as he and Worsley were pacing around that night, he looked at the cliff and realized that the water line was above their tents. So that means they couldn't stay there. They had to get to some place. So the next morning, as soon as they got up, the worst news in the world they heard, back into the boats and further down the coast. And this was the final place where they actually made camp for the first time. Now, here they are on Elephant Island. What is Elephant Island? Even Captain Cook had never stopped there 135 years before that. So nobody ever came to Elephant Island. Think about that for a minute. So that means they had to do it themselves. How were they going to do it? So what Shackleton decided, one lifeboat would go for help, and the other two would be stacked up over there, the men would sleep in it, etc. And that's how they would. But where would they go? So they couldn't go back to Cape Horn because the current, they would have to go across the current. And in a small lifeboat, that would be impossible. For the same reason, they couldn't go to the Falkland Islands, because that meant crossing the current too. So probably the best way was to head all the way back to South Georgia. That was 800 nautical miles. That's about 1,500 kilometers of open sea in the worst weather in the world. This was winter was setting in, remember. So, tough decision, that's how it had to be. So he gathered the men around him and he asked for volunteers. And amazingly, he got a handful of volunteers. So once he got the volunteers and he saw that, you know, spirit was still there amongst the men, then he told them who was going to man the boat. He was going to command, of course, he got them into this, so he now he was going to get them out of it. Worsley had to come with him because Worsley had to navigate. Tom Crean and Tim McCarthy were two strong sailors. He would need them for dependability. And then the last two guys, who would you have chosen? Well, the ones he chose. One was McNeish, who'd let him down at that critical moment. And the other was Vincent, the troublesome sailor. And he wasn't going to leave them behind for Frank Wilde to have to control while he went for help. Now McNeish did a terrific job, strengthening the strongest of the three boats. It was called the James Caird. he put in ballast, and the ballast consisted of rocks which he put into sacks and put them at the bottom of the boat. He put in a mast at the bottom for rigidity, and then he sealed the seams at the top with paint from Marston, the artist, and seal's blood, hoping that that would keep it. And then on April 24th, they set off.
The next morning.
That's where they were going. A half a degree error meant they would miss the island and they'd be lost for good. That's the degree of...
The next morning, the 22 men who will be left behind gather on shore. The optimists expect the boss back in a few weeks. Shackleton and five other men face the world's most vicious sea in a 23-foot open boat. Elephant Island, April 24th, 1916.
We watched them until they were out of sight, which was not long, for such a tiny boat soon lost the sight on the great heaving ocean. As she dipped into the trough of each wave, she disappeared completely, sailing on.
3 days out, their craft is hit by a powerful gale. Enormous waves, 50 or more feet high, batter them relentlessly as they struggle in a last desperate effort to reach help.
And these men were in this tiny 23-foot boat for 16 days altogether, being tossed around with these wet reindeer clothes and reindeer sleeping bags chafing them, and great wet rocks of ballast bumping against them in huge waves. I mean, they were in storm conditions, gale conditions, virtually for the entire time of the crossing. And I think Worsley only had one chance to take a sighting from the sun to work out their position, and the rest was done entirely on dead reckoning.
On May 8th, against all odds, the men sight the South Georgia coast. They spend nearly 2 days trying to make a landing on the island's treacherous shores.
They get the guy forward. And it is the most wild coast with huge glaciers flowing down into the sea. And I think it was just as they finally managed to get through some rocks into this tiny little bay and drag the boat ashore, stumbling and slithering on wet rocks and seaweed, that the main pin holding the rudder fell out just at that moment as they landed. Incredible fortune that it had lasted till then.
What you're seeing here is Worsley, who had incredibly brought them through yet another miracle. And just to tell you what a sextant is, for those of you who don't know, basically what you do is you line up, you sight the sun, you line it up, and then you see the difference between the angle and the horizon. And that's what you're basically doing. Then what you have to do is quickly get to your charts. You want to do all that at the same time. So you get to your charts, and then from your charts, you read out where you are. And that gives you your position. Now, he was doing that in this bucking boat, this tiny little 23-foot lifeboat. It's ridiculous. And that's what he was doing. So three men had to hold him down, keep him thin while he took his sighting. Then they had to make sure that he got all his charts, which he had to read out there in this bucking boat. And then he knew where they were. Now what you just heard Stephen Venable saying was that he only got one. Actually, he got three partial sightings. In three partial sightings, this man got them across 1,500 kilometers dead on. He was a genius. Now, it landed on May 10th. It's the greatest small boat journey that still stands today, has ever been done. A 23-foot boat, it was like committing suicide. And here they have, they made it across. But they landed on the wrong side of the island. So now, the boat is too damaged to sail across. It's 150 miles around the coast. So now, they've got to walk across. Remember what I told you about South Georgia? Unmapped. They didn't know how far they had to go. They knew it would be roughly in the region of about 32 miles. 32 miles of untracked waste. And these guys now have to do that if they're going to get to the other side, otherwise they die over there quietly. So, that's what they had to do. So, that's how they had to walk across, all the way to Stromness Bay, which was where the whaling station was. And, as I mentioned to you, the island wouldn't be mapped until 40 years in the future. Then storms descended for about 10 days, and this deeply depressed Shackleton, because above all, he was a man of action. And what was he thinking about? As Worsley wrote in his diary, all he kept talking about was the men left on Elephant Island. He had to get somewhere to rescue the men. So all they had with them was, by the way, only three of them could walk, because Vincent and McNeish were now just too done in to walk. McNeish, remember, Vincent had been the strongest of the sailors. Now he was too weak to walk. So McCarthy had to be left behind to look after him. McCarthy was the sailor. And Shackleton, Crean, and Worsley would have to do the walking across. So what McNeish did for them was he rammed nails through the sole of their shoes, just to get some purchase on the ice, because they'd be walking across ice. And they set off with a watch, not just to tell the time, but as we'll see later why that was important. They had 3 days' food with them. Obviously, they had no tents or sleeping bags. And they had to march those 32 miles in one go if they had to have any chance of escaping the terrible weather along on Elephant Island.
Fate compels them to land on the side of the island opposite the whaling station, which lies over an interior of glaciers and mountains that no human being has ever crossed. Terribly weakened, Shackleton is called on to lead yet another heroic effort. He has a bit of rope, a carpenter's axe, and some screws which the men twist into the bottom of their shoes. Leaving behind the three men who were too ill to make the trip, Shackleton sets off with Frank Worsley and Tom Crean.
Shackleton was a polar expert, he was a seaman, but he wasn't really a mountaineer. And yet, when they arrived on the wrong side of South Georgia and had to cross it, they were having to do a very serious bit of mountaineering. And I think that's where this incredible intuition came in. They knew roughly where they were going, but they had no maps.
At one point, Shackleton finds himself at the top of an impossibly steep slope. Once again, he decides to take an enormous gamble.
But by this time, night was falling, and the mist was covering the bottom of the slope. They had no idea what was at the bottom. They tried a few steps down, but it was evident that if they continued, they would die of exposure. So they coiled their rope down, the three of them sat on it, and they put their arms around each other's waists, and they pushed off into space.
They careen crazily down a 1,000-foot mountainside. At the bottom, they are bruised and torn. But to have survived at all is another in a long line of miracles.
So they kept on going. After a few hours, they'd now been walking for 26 hours. So they were exhausted, obviously. So they stopped and they sat down together. Shackleton put his arms around the others and he let them sleep. He let them sleep for 5 minutes. Because if they slept any longer than that, he knew they would never wake up. And he told them that they'd slept for half an hour. Then they noticed the time on the watch, and it was 6:30 a.m. So they realized that they couldn't get a fix on exactly where they were at that point, because at 7 o'clock, the ship's horns would sound in Stromness Bay. They knew that from the time that they'd spent over there. So they waited breathlessly for it, and at 7 o'clock sharp came the sound. It was the first man-made sound they heard in over 17 months. So now they knew they were on the right track. But they still had a hell of a long way to go before they could get there. So finally, they went climbing uphill, downhill, several weary hours, and then finally, the path, they could see the whaling station across the thing, but they had to go downhill very sharply, and part of the way went through a 50-foot waterfall. There wasn't any other way, they had to go down through the waterfall. So first they lowered Crean, who was the heaviest, then Worsley let down Shackleton, and finally Worsley, who was the lightest, came down last, left the rope hanging over there, and the other side was the whaling station. As they entered the whaling station, they asked two little boys the way, and the boys just ran from them in terror, as did an older man who he bumped into along the way. Then they realized how they looked after 15 months of grime, dirt, long beards. Worsley's only concern, actually, funnily enough, which he confided to his diary later, was their torn clothes in case they bumped into any ladies. So he found some safety pins or something, so he tied together his clothes, etc. And they reached the manager's office. His man outside told him, went in and told the manager there were three funny looking men standing outside who said they'd come across the island and that they knew him. So he went out, and the first apparition said to him, "Don't you know me?" So the manager lied, saying, "Yeah, I think I know your voice." And he said, "I'm Ernest Shackleton." Now they say that the manager went, because these guys had long, long months ago had long been given up for dead. Anyway, he took them in. Obviously, he bathed them, they shaved, they fed, and a couple of hours on, they heard the storm break outside. If they'd been fortunate, it was over. So once again, their luck had held out. And his diary entry that night was a quote from a favorite poet of his, who's a chap called Robert Service. And in it he says, "In memories we were rich, we'd pierced the veneer of outside things. We'd seen God in his splendor, heard the text that nature renders, we'd reached the naked soul of man." And then Shackleton checked with the Admiralty, because now he had to rescue the men. So he left immediately, the whalers, of course, helped him with the boat to get to the mainland. The Admiralty refused to give him any help, because the war was still going on. He didn't realize that. The war was still going on. So they went to the Falklands, they got a boat from the Falklands, they couldn't break through the ice. They went back there, they went to Argentina. Argentina gave them a boat, they couldn't get through the ice around Elephant Island. Finally, they went to Chile, and a Chilean tugboat helped them make it through the ice.
Less than 3 days later, Ernest Shackleton leaves South Georgia to return for his men on Elephant Island. It takes him more than 3 months and four different attempts. On August 30th, 1916, he finally sights the dismal coast. A signal fire can be seen burning faintly. Shackleton, though, has no way of knowing how many of his men are still alive. Yet on the beach is gathering the entire Elephant Island crew.
He's asking Worsley, "Are they all there? Are they all there?"
On shore, the realization slowly sinks in that the boat is really there, that the unendurable has been endured. Ernest Shackleton, the boss, has come to take them home.
So obviously it was a highly emotional moment, and when they sailed into Punta Arenas in Chile, the entire town, along with, by the way, its large complement of German residents who had gone to take up residence there, turned out to see these already legendary sailors who literally returned from the dead. And remember, he brought all his men back alive, which was an unknown factor at that time. Funnily enough, when they got back to England, the Battle of Jutland had just ended when they got back, which was of course the last action between steel battleships, and the British fared very poorly in that. So they returned to anonymity. The King, of course, sent him a congratulatory message, but with the war still raging, many of the men, and you see them lined up for the last photograph before they dispersed, went straight to the front. McCarthy, the lion-hearted sailor who went with him across the sea, was the first to get shot. He was machine gun. Shackleton himself demanded to be drafted, and they didn't know what to do with this guy. So they finally sent him off to northern Russia, to Murmansk, and they sent with him Worsley, Wild, Macklin, Hussey, and the others, just to get them off their shoulders. And they said, at least he knows the cold, so send him to North Russia. After the war, he took a last expedition to the Antarctic and died of a heart attack of South Georgia in 1922. He was 47. Then followed 40 years nearly of anonymity. The only person who was known was Spock. Nobody remembered Shackleton. Then, funnily enough, when South Georgia was being mapped for the first time in the 50s, suddenly people began to realize how extraordinary Shackleton's expedition had been. Today, it's a Harvard University casebook study. Admirers include past secretaries of the US Navy, even the commander of the Apollo 13 mission, and founders of various Wall Street investor funds. Now, I wondered to myself, for all of you, how relevant is he today? And when I was thinking through the challenges that we face in building up the skills that are going to take us through the next 25 years, years in which technology and artificial intelligence are going to make many of today's jobs redundant as computer processing power doubles every 2 years. And that implies that infotech power is going to increase by a factor of a million in, let's say, 40 years, while simultaneously increasing the complex algorithms that let computers handle complex tasks using less computing power. Computing visionary Bill Joy pointed out that jet travel, being faster than walking by a factor of 100, changed the world. And now there's this factor of 1 million. Let's instead think of activities which we humans will continue to insist be performed by other humans, even if computers could do that better. And thinking like that makes it possible to surmise that not computer abilities, but just sheer social necessity will drive individuals being accountable for important decisions that are going to highlight work that needs us. So human judges, CEOs, generals, government leaders at every level are probably going to remain in their roles for a long, long time to come. Problems that require humans rather than computers for purely practical reasons. Because in real life, especially in organizational life, we keep changing our perception of what the problem is and what our goals are. Issues that people have to work out for themselves. Critically in groups, because groups solve problems better than individuals do. And also all that work that we must do with or for other human beings. Because our most essential human nature demands it for reasons that are just hardwired into our evolutionary past, to equate personal relationships with with survival. When our forebears, for example, began coming out of Africa all those millennia ago, they worked with each other to solve problems, to tell each other stories, and to hear stories from them, to create new ideas with them. Because if they didn't do that, they died. And there's clear evidence that the most effective groups are those whose members possess these deeply essential, deeply human abilities, empathy, social sensitivity, storytelling, collaborating, solving problems together, building relationships, developed with other people, not machines. We want to follow human leaders. We want to hear our diagnosis from a doctor, even if a computer mapped it, because we want to talk to the doctor about it, and we want to be heard by them. We want to negotiate important agreements with a person. We want to look into his eyes. In fact, looking into someone's eyes turns out to be quite literally, not just metaphorically, the key to high-value work in the coming economy. And this isn't theory. It's actually happening as changes in the nature of work take on a significant scale. And findings of different research groups in the world concur on these findings. Now, think back to Ernest Shackleton. Working out life and death situations that kept popping up on his expedition as things changed from moment to moment, his conduct during those 2 years in the wilderness, far from any outside influence, under the worst possible conditions of the planet, embodied these very factors as he related to his men and they related to him. He rallied them through good times, through bad times. He molded them into a team to face the most horrendous, horrendous conditions on earth. He lifted them above themselves and their individual abilities to be better than they were. And he brought them all back alive at the time that really happened. In fact, as the captain of the Norwegian whalers said when he was toasting Shackleton before he left South Georgia to rescue his men from Elephant Island, these were hardened men of the sea, knowing only too well what it took to stay alive in the Antarctic. And they puzzled to themselves how these guys had stayed alive first for 14 months. Then they crossed the worst waters in the world in winter in a 23-foot boat. And then walked across an unmapped stormy island, all to rescue his men. And he merely turned to all his men, saying simply, "These are men." Thank you, sir.
Thank you for marvelously letting us experience the whole expedition and the message of leadership that followed. May I request our president, Mr. Yatin Kapolkar, to kindly take the seat on the dais. We will now have a short Q&A or a session on comments that you would have, which Mr. Krishna will be very happy to answer.
The nature of this journey being so incredibly overwhelming that people find it a little difficult immediately to respond to this. Questions about how this happened or that happened or what were they feeling like or whatever. So that's perfectly understandable. So if you find yourself needing some time to think about it, that's absolutely fine. I think you heard somebody Twitter your suggestions to me. If anybody has any thoughts or even a comment or whatever, I'll be delighted to.
This expedition, I'm going back to the Himalaya, where before the expedition starts, there is a platform where everyone settles down and then they move with the Sherpa to the mountains.
The base, Mexico?
The base, yeah. I'm talking about the narrow base of 15 years. Before we go, we pray and make a lot of prayers and puja and all kinds. And then we start with the divine mercy, divine power. Your whole story was just the men and their bravery. You never mentioned about any willpower in the form of divinity. That's mine.
Let that story relate for itself the kind of divinity that these men created. They created that through their interactions. Call it what you like. It was something greater than all of them. And in some, for some of us, that equates to divinity. For some of us, that there are more mundane words to describe it, like leadership or what have you. That's the thoughts that occurred to me. But that may well not be an adequate answer to your query.
Hi, my name is Nandini Vaisyanathan. More comment on what my takeaway is in terms of leadership. So I think this argument that leaders are born or can they be made, I think there's a huge lesson here that we become leaders only when we get into a situation which demands leadership. Shackleton possibly would have been just an ordinary guy had he not been an expert. I think that's one part of it. The second part of it, I think, is the goal was simplified for his men and for himself. The goal was phenomenally simplified. I think in organizations, we don't get the best because we confuse the goals. Here, the goal was to reach, and failed at reaching, to survive. There was no argument about it, and there was no confusion either in Shackleton's mind or in the minds of others. I think it was a success in that sense of the term on account of this kitchery of all of these.
I think there was a little more going on than just that. And those are what I refer to as the indefinable that was taking place in the relationships between these men as this extraordinary situation kept getting into uncharted territory, having to deal with situations that they weren't really equipped for, and even to get through them. Which was part of what I mentioned right at the start, that when people set off on these expeditions in those times, that you weren't really prepared for what could happen to you at different times, because nobody knew the conditions at that time. So these guys were really heading into uncharted territory in that sense.
Isn't it the same in organizations too? When I join as an intern,
yes.
I don't know what's in store.
Yes.
The brochure and the media have painted a particular picture of the organization, which is very different from what it actually is.
Thank
it's
you. Like, yeah. Yes. No, you're absolutely right. It's just that the situation that faced these guys was multiplied that by a factor of 10. So you could ask yourself, why did these chaps even go on it? Because that's part of the indefinable. Why do people climb mountains? Why do people put their lives at risk?
Because they're there.
Exactly.
Yeah. I was a colonel in the army, and I've been in Seattle. And I would like to think that there is a certain amount of similarity. Certain degrees could be debate that in going into uncharted territory, not knowing what is there, conditions may have been similar, the ground conditions, weather, the climate, the preparation, especially the mental preparation of the men, of the troops, etc., going in there. Which could be to a certain extent compared to the ship which went across. And the leaders, the captains, the officers who like Shackleton, though they were more trained and better prepared, would be in charge of their men, could be in charge of the aid, could be in charge of the reason why they are there in the first place, which may be slightly different from Shackleton, where they were going to explore. Whereas in Siachen, you're not going to explore. You're doing something else there. But you're also exploring at the same time because you don't know. It's like the uncharted So there's a double whammy there. So I would like to think that yes, I mean, I can sort of visualize Shackleton's this thing because they were there for 2 years, whereas in Siachen there's a turnover of 6 months. Psychologically and otherwise, the human body does not, you go off. So, I mean, I can imagine that it was quite a, quite a journey, and survival becomes intrinsic. We all survive. We all have the survival instinct. It needs to be triggered off. And if you're with men, then the survival instinct is a little different with others, that is. Or when you're alone, then the survival instinct is on a different level or a different plane altogether. So I just wanted to say this, that his leadership is very much like you would have in a well-organized organization, disciplined organization, like say the army or whichever else you could, in the Navy, for the Navy. That's what I would like to draw the comparison between what is happening here with what happened, a century earlier, on a different plane, but maybe in the same lines.
I think one of the other points of difference is that his organization, Shackleton's organization, was a little different from a Royal Navy operation, which was charted out, we behaved in certain ways. Officers didn't fraternize with men, those lines are to be kept, etc., which maybe under certain circumstances lends a certain amount of order, let us say, at least mine. But of course, nobody knows how minds work under when situations go well beyond what's the normal. And the extraordinary bonds that he created. In a time when all these things was less understood than they are perhaps now, again was the welding of these disparate groups of people. And I can't really underline for you how important that was, let's say between men and officers and scientists, etc. Because keeping the balance on those guys and then having them all turn to you after a while.
I think he could do it because he didn't go to a business school.
That's a possibility.
Wall Street, man.
First, I want to thank you for the beautiful narrative.
Yes.
You really called it the whole scene. In fact, it felt that we were all there when the whole sequence of sharing was going on. I'm very happy at least you brought up something very critical in what we teach. I'm a management educator, I teach at business schools. The fact that leadership is a people issue. Because we read a lot of literature that's happening with the fourth industrial revolution, the technology interface, you review to be brought out. But still, I think in spite of whatever is happening in terms of technology, leadership of many people will remain a critical issue for the rest of our lives as a BBC. And under different circumstances, I feel that dimension always emerges. How you deal with each individual will make the real difference in life. And the only issue is that, do we have the resilience to keep on doing that all the time? So it's a very serious issue, but a very important issue in terms of making organizations successful or your purpose successful.
Yes, and often, I think, in my experience, you need to create some glue to make that happen. And this particular case relates an immense amount of glue that formed because here it is a matter of life or death, literally, at several points along that. And it's interesting that, and I make a mention of this because I think one needs to, that at the other end of the Ross Sea, he had another group of people who came from New Zealand, the New Zealand side, to lay the food dumps which they were going to join up with. those guys had pine tents amongst them. And again, you know, mistakes of leadership, mistakes of human mistakes, etc., etc. So it's just a very fascinating story where he made everything right, leading from the front, even though it's a story from behind.
No ceremonious, but very significant exercise. Propose the vote of thanks. At the outset, on behalf of ICG, as well as each one of us present over here, we thank Mr. Vijay Krishna for such a lively and highly knowledgeable presentation and for taking us through the expedition. I would also like to thank the institutions that supported us by giving very positive response to Mr. Krishna's lecture. And this includes CII Goa, CII Young Indians, Goa Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Goa Management Association, Goa Trainers Association, Goa HR Forum, Goa Institute of Management and Goa University's Department of Management Studies, Goa Hiking Association, Association of Friends of Astronomy Goa, Goa Yachting Association, EcoTrex Goa, Enduro Sports Goa, Goa Cycling Club, Youth Hostel Associations of India, and many other organizations. I'd also like to thank Mr. Krishna and his family, Mrs. Smita Krishna Godrej, Ms. Nairika, and Ms. Yashwanta Holkar for accompanying Mr. Krishna to Goa and also for being present here for the lecture. Ms. Dagma Fernandez particularly for providing us all the support that we required for making this lecture happen. I would also like to express my gratitude to Mr. Sanjeev Trivedi, not just for introducing Mr. Krishna this morning, but playing a very major role in planning and organizing and making this lecture happen. Last but not the least, on behalf of ICG, I would like to thank each one of you who are present here for taking time off your busy schedule to attend and participate in this lecture and to make it interactive. It wouldn't have been possible to have this successful lecture without your presence. Thank you very much. And before we leave, I once again request each one of you to kindly fill up the feedback forms that have been given to you and present it at the registration desk and like our Facebook page to be updated of the programs that we regularly organize and follow us on our Twitter. Thank you very much.